I'm Carlos Villamar. I'm a patent attorney. I'm also an inventor, and I'm also in aquaponics, if anybody's into that. I have a law firm that actually helps with small inventors, and I'm not going to go into that because we're not pitching our own businesses here. But I do want to talk about a problem that all startups have, and it's basically they need the money to get the IP, and they need the IP to get the money. And unfortunately, the conventional model of selling you patents for $5,000 to $10,000 to $20,000 per patent doesn't really serve the startup industry very well. Back in 2013, the patent laws were changed. $800 million in lobbying by 10 of the richest corporations on earth. It's called the America Invents Act. Most people have not heard of it. It got zero press coverage. I travel to Finland quite a bit, and I say, if you give me $800 million, I can change the laws, and nobody will hear about it. And that particular law, quote, harmonized with Europe. And I was traveling to Europe quite a bit to work with startups in Finland, and they kept telling me, we don't file patents, they're too expensive, we can't afford them, they can attack you before, during, and after. And very naively, I was like, well, in America, I get my company's patents, and they become startups, and they get bought by Google. Enter the America Invents Act. All that changed. I gave a talk at the IEEE on the various provisions that were added. And I just about cried on stage. I said, you know, I used to tell startups that you have a 1 in 1,000 chance of making it. And this is pretty close. You know, I've worked with probably about that many startups, and about that many have really made it. And after the America Invents Act, I said, now it's 1 in 10,000 or 1 in 20,000, if you're lucky. And the problem is, if you have technology, you need to protect it. And what the lawyers are not telling you, you know, they tell you, hey, you need your patent, and you get your patent. And I always tell startups that come to me with that and say, hey, I've got my patent. I go, let me tell you the good news and the bad news. The good news is you have a patent. The bad news is you need 100 more. And that was the problem I was trying to solve. And, you know, as a startup, how do you file 100 patents at 10 to 20,000 a patent? You don't. And the problem is that the legal industry is not serving the startup community properly. So after the America Invents Act, I decided to solve that problem, and that's what I'm going to talk about tonight. And the way I solved the problem, I'm an engineer, you know, and engineers solve problems. That's what we do. So I started analyzing the America Invents Act and trying to figure out, why is it that the corporations want first to file? Well, because they have an army of lawyers. They can get to the patent office way faster than you can. You know, why do they want to be able to attack you before, during, and after? Well, because it costs about $40,000 to $200,000 to attack somebody. And, it, you know, are startups going to be attacking Google, or is Google going to be, you know, attacking startups? And I'm not picking on Google, by the way. I just mean corporations in general. So that was the problem. And I had done work with patent pooling. I worked on the digital rights management patent pool. I also worked with lots of startups. And my model that I created is I teach the startups what I know in order to minimize my time. Because you're looking at the most expensive part of a patent. It's me. It's the patent attorney. The filing fees are in the noise. So I started teaching startups what I do, but that really wasn't enough because I was only impacting a few startups. And they always say that an invention starts when the light bulb goes off. And I was sitting there, you know, thinking, how can I get around the Americans in vet tech? What can I do to actually help startups? And I realized after working in these patent pools that one company filing 1,000 patents is the equivalent of 1,000 small inventors filing one patent. Think about that. One company filing 1,000 patents is the equivalent of 1,000 small inventors filing one patent, everything else being equal. In other words, the portfolios will have the same value. In fact, the portfolios of the inventors will have more value because they will be diverse inventions, whereas the company patents will be probably overlapping. So I realized that that was the model, but by the same token, I wanted to work with the open source community. And, you know, the open source community has shunted patents, and for the right reason. You know, it's too expensive for them, so they open source everything. The problem with open source, though, is that you end up becoming the R&D arm of a corporation. So I wanted to solve that problem, and what I did is I realized that if we protect and then open source and then monetize, with most of the monetization going to the inventor, that I could solve the problem. And that's the OU812 Open Collaboration Engine. And we're looking for small inventors and startups, universities, and you know, small inventors as well. And the way the model works is the innovators set the time. They set the terms. And basically, you know, I'm trying to create a system that allows the little people to compete fairly with the corporations, and also to be able to monetize the invention. So basically, the way this works is, we form teams around technology areas. Right now we have AI. I've got about 50 closed groups on Facebook on every technology you can imagine. Tonight I'm going to start a women in technology group because of somebody that I was speaking to here earlier. And the concept is that the innovators come in and they say, hey, we've got this project. And I come in as a patent attorney on the team, and I help them, you know, for whatever equity stake they want to give away. Same thing with the money person, same thing with the marketing person. But the idea is that when the IP portfolio gets monetized, most of the money goes to the innovators. So we're talking about intellectual property rights protection and sharing and monetization. And we're also looking for team players. OU812 is not going to be open to everybody. People tell me how I'm going to scale it. I don't want to scale it. I actually want to create teams of highly motivated people. I'm ex-military, and I want to create sort of like special forces of tech teams. So I'm not looking for the me people that want to be the next Google. I'm looking for people that want to collaborate and form teams. All the intellectual property that OU812 produces is free for educational and personal use. Everybody else pays. And that's the concept. And so I think that's pretty much it. And right now, we've got some patents in the sustainable agriculture area. They're actually my patents. It's the biggest portfolio in the group right now. We have 5 U.S. patents granted, another U.S. patent pending, and a PCT application pending. PCT gives you the ability to protect the world, assuming you have enough money to protect the world when the time comes. And the way OU812 works is sort of interesting. We have some architects on the team. And for example, I handed them my patents on my greenhouse technology, and they converted it into buildings. And now we're going to file patents covering the buildings based on the patented technology. And that's the way OU812 works, is when you put your IP into the pool, the way we encourage other people to put their IP into the pool is by, first of all, the people that have the project, I want the innovators to get the lion's share of the monetization, because I'm trying to create a system that helps the innovators. However, if your patent gets accepted into the OU812 model, it's going to be like a neural network where there's different technology areas. And when one technology area hits, gets monetized, most of the monetization goes to that particular group, project team, but some monetization goes to all the other people that have put their IP into the overall OU812 pool. And we're going to create open collaboration across all fields. So the people in health will work with the people in AI, will work with the people in aquaculture, et cetera. And we're very excited. We've got right now about, I think I'm up to about 40 closed groups on Facebook. The mycology group is actually one of the biggest groups. We have some top scientists in the mycology area. We're looking at micro remediation. We're looking at micromaterials. The hemp material group is another group that we're looking at very heavily. And that's the basic concept, but it's going to require teamwork and participation and the willingness to share your ideas with everybody, and the ability to also want to have your technology be open for personal and educational use. So those are the basic requirements. And that's pretty much it for OU812. So I can take questions, comments. Yes.
Hold on. So just so everyone knows, if you do have a question, I will come around and okay. I will repeat the question for you. You can talk in the mic, whichever you prefer.
I have a question in regards to knowledge transfer. So, you know, basically with the rate of technology, your patents 5-7 years ago are actually obsolete.
Yeah.
The big issue is key or critical employees who leave, and I think there's a couple of cases happening right now in California, left from, I think, Oculus to somewhere else, or vice versa, and from Tesla to Uber, and they took their knowledge with them, but those individuals are actually being sued by their former employers. So how would you address that in your own?
Well, the way we're addressing that is the system is going to be captured in the blockchain, and all transactions are going to be actually captured, including all the monetization and all the terms. And we're going to do it through contracts. In other words, we want to prevent poaching, for lack of a better term, or also from somebody bringing in a bunch of crap patents. You know, so the people that are in the team, you know, the OU812 team, they get to vote on which IP comes into the group. And, you know, once the group, once it gets admitted in the group, the members are sort of on a trial period. But the short answer is we're going to handle it through contracts. And I've done trade secret violation actions and stuff like that. They're nasty. You know, there's no golden bullet. You know, people leave and they take their knowledge with them. But the way the OU812 works is at least we will have the IP, you know, so... So yes, you know, their internal know-how or trade secrets, they may be able to try to steal, but as far as the IP itself, it will be protected.